my friends. Welcome to online worship from Hanover, Pennsylvania. My name is Pastor Greg, senior pastor of First United Methodist Church in Hanover, Pennsylvania. And you could probably guess it just by looking at me, but I'm having a major case of spring fever right now. The temperatures topped 70 degrees this past week, and spring is here. We might get a few more cold days, but spring is here. Easter and the celebration of the resurrection is just around the corner, and warmer days are coming. And I think you're about as happy with that as I am. So we're gonna share that joy. We're gonna find some ways to thank God for His blessings, and we're also continuing our Lenten series on how to pray and communicate with God. And today we're learning how to pray with the Holy Scriptures. It's called sacred reading, and we're going to learn how to do that in just a moment. So whatever you have on your heart, whether it's a deep and heavy burden, please give it to God today, and you will feel lighter by the end of this hour. If you have joy, bring Him your thanks. We're going to begin this time of worship with some song.
Rejoicing in His presence and welcoming the light of His truth. We ask this in the name of Jesus the Lord. Amen.
They tell me Jesus died for my transgressions, that He paid the price a long, long time ago, when He gave His life for me on a hill called Calvary. But there's something else I want to know. Does He still feel the nails every time I fail? Can He hear the crowd cry, "Crucify again"? am I causing him pain, then I know I've got to change. I just can't bear the thought of hurting him. It seems that I'm so good at breaking promises, and I treat his precious grace so carelessly. But each time he forgives, what if he relives the agony he felt on that tree? Does he still feel the nails every time I fail? Can he hear the crowd cry, "Crucify again"? Am I causing him pain? Then I know I've got to change. I just can't bear the thought of hurting him. Crucified you, Jesus, with my sin. Oh, I'm tired of playing games. I really want to change. I never want to hurt you again.
Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. The third day, he arose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Hi, everybody. I'm so glad you're here to worship. Do you remember last week we talked about prayer? And we talked about some fun ways to pray, like with the jelly beans and with our hand. God loves us so much. He wants us to know him. And he loves us no matter what we do. Talking to our friends and family is pretty easy, right? I don't know why, but sometimes it seems like it's really hard to pray. Maybe we get busy, Maybe because we can't see God, we think he's not really listening. And we wonder if God really wants to hear about our problems, like I hurt my toe, my friend called me a name. But you know what? God wants us to know him. So that's the truth. That is the truth. God wants us to know him. He really does answer prayer. And God loves us through our prayer. And we can love God with our prayer too. Talking to God isn't hard. It can be as simple as talking to somebody else that you love. So I came up with this little thing. It starts with a T for taking time. You have to take time to talk to God. Over here. The A is sometimes we need to be quiet so we can stop listening to all the stuff that's going around us and listen for the whisper of God's words. The next letter is L. Now, L is interesting because we need to learn about God's word. And K is maybe we need to have a little bit of a plan about what we want to talk to God about. Because sometimes, like if you're somebody like me, you could just talk and talk and talk and not really say anything. So sometimes it's nice to have a little list or a journal. So this is the word talk. Take time for some quiet. Learn about God's word and keep a plan. Now today, I know that Pastor Greg is going to talk about praying with the scriptures. So I challenged myself a little bit and I found some scriptures in God's holy book. Y'all know what this is. Look at all the words in here. There's so many words that tell us that God loves us. It's full of his love. So I just went to the very beginning and I found Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Good Bible verse, right? Then I found another verse in Psalm 136:1, and that says, "Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever." Endures is a weird word, but it means it lasts forever. So let's put those two Bible verses together and see if we can't think of a prayer. Okay, you might need to help me from home. So if God created the heavens and the earth, and we should say thanks to God because he loves us, what is something on the earth we could say thank you to God for? How about the trees? That's right. The ocean, maybe the whales and the fish, the mountains, the stars, the sun. Wow. See how that worked? We used God's words to come up with a prayer. So let's pray that prayer right now. Are you ready? Thank you, God, for loving us forever, no matter what. Thank you, God, for the world that you made. The trees, the mountains, the oceans, the flowers, the stars, and the sun. Thank you, God. Amen. We did it, guys. We prayed through the scripture. So it's not as hard as what it sounds, is it? It's pretty easy. Remember, wash those hands, say your prayers, because germs and Jesus really are everywhere. Bye, everyone.
Please give your attention to the scripture lesson, Deuteronomy 6:1-9. Now this is the commandment, the statutes and the rules that the Lord your God commanded me to teach you, that you may do them in the land to which you are going over to possess it, that you may fear the Lord your God, you and your son and your son's sons, by keeping all his statutes and his commandments, which I command you all the days of your life, and that your days may be long. Hear therefore, O Israel, and be careful to do them, that it may go well with you, and that you may multiply greatly, as the Lord, the God of your fathers, has promised you, and a land flowing with milk and honey. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. And these words that I command you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk to them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates.
God speaks. Did you know that? All around us, all the time, God is constantly communicating his thoughts and his desires for us. Now, a lot of people don't believe that because they've never heard God out loud, like in the movies. Maybe that's why the idea of having a personal love relationship with God is so hard for us to wrap our minds around. We've prayed and we've prayed and we've prayed. We've talked ourselves till we're blue in the face, dumping out everything on our minds. We have asked our questions. We have begged for answers, but we never seem to hear any reply. But God is speaking. We just need a little help tuning God in. Roman Catholic author M. Basil Pennington explains it beautifully. He observes that at this exact second, this room where I am and the room where you are is filled with all kinds of voices and music. Can you hear it? Of course not. They surround us as radio waves that can't be heard by the human ears. We need a radio to tune them in to a frequency that we can hear and understand. You've all used a radio before. You know how that works. Well, it's kind of the same with the voice of God. God can miraculously speak in a tangible voice that all people can hear, but day to day, God is speaking in a different frequency, a spiritual frequency. And there is no radio on earth that can tune in that spiritual frequency of God. But it can be done by using a Bible. The Bible is central to our faith because we read and we learn about God in the past. Knowing what God has already done and what God promises to do in the future, it gives us hope for what we may do in the future and how it might go with us. But there is a prayerful way of reading the Bible that allows us to experience what God is doing right now, live and in person. And it is an ancient practice with a Latin name called Lectio Divina. Now, Lectio is a Latin word that simply means reading, and Divina means sacred. So this means a sacred reading of the Scriptures. It's the practice of reading the Scriptures in order to encounter and experience God. For over 1,000 years, Christians have used this devotional reading of Scripture, assuming that by entering into the text of God's holy word, God will be made known to us, will speak to us, and will shape our lives. Author and pastor Eugene Peterson states it this way. He says, "We do not read this book and the subsequent writings that are shaped by it in order to find out how to get God into our lives." No, he says, we open the book and we find that page after page, it takes us off guard. It surprises us. It draws us into its reality. It pulls us into participation with God on God's terms. So Lectio Divina is not about meticulous, calculated study in which we catalog all the promises and then all the sins and all the warnings and all the blessings of God. It's not intended as a history of God in which we track all the names and the dates and the places of great events. Instead, it is a love affair with God where we just let the Scriptures loose so that they can run rampant in our lives, flipping our world upside down. So as you can imagine, the discipline of sacred reading will take a different approach to reading Scripture than we might be used to. Now, it's not difficult, and it employs only 4 simple steps. You can write these down if you've got a pen and a paper. The first step is called Lectio, or that simply means reading it. After you choose a verse or a passage of Scripture, one story, one section, one verse, you just read it. Read the passage slowly and reflect on it. Think about what you're reading. Reading it twice. Imagine it. Listen to the sounds. Hear what's going on. See the sights. Smell the smells and feel the warmth or the cold. You may want to read it repeatedly, 2 or 3 times, reading it more slowly each time. Well, once you've done that, the second stage is meditatio, or reflection. During this stage, you identify an image or a word or a thought or a phrase that came to you while you read, and you just reflect deeply on it. Think about it. Ponder it. Turn it over and over again in your mind, like we talked about last week. Meditate upon it. Thinking about the good things of God. And then you allow that image or word or phrase to interact with your thoughts, your dreams, your hopes, your doubts. Focus on whatever captures your attention. A word, a question, a character in the story. Whatever grabs you, stay with it and mull it over. And then the third stage is oratio, which is about speaking. It really means respond. During this stage, you allow your heart to simply speak to God. Respond about what you've heard. Now, we learned about this 2 weeks ago when we said that prayer is being completely honest with God about what's going on around us and inside of us. Whatever you are feeling or thinking about this scripture that you've been mulling over, tell God about it. Ask your questions. Share your insights. Talk it over. Enjoy it together with God. And then, when you finally talked yourself out in prayer and it's time for the fourth step, contemplatio, isn't that a funny word? Or what that means is rest. We learned about that a couple of weeks ago, about that need for silence, to be quiet on the inside as the world is around us. Now, during this stage, you allow yourself to let go of those thoughts and those ideas and those feelings and even the words. It's a time where you can just sit there and rest in God's presence. Sit on God's lap and just rest together, drawing comfort and strength and peace from just being in God's presence. That's it. Read, think, pray, rest. And doing this, we tune in the voice of God, allowing God to guide us and shape us. God speaks through that process. And it is so vital to us. God joins us to him in this time as much as possible. Now listen to what Moses commands. We heard this just a moment ago in our scripture. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all of your soul, with all of your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them upon your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. He instructs the people to spend as much time as possible reading, discussing, thinking, and reflecting and meditating upon the law and the commandments of God. Why so much? Why every day? Well, we know the answer to that now. It is how we tune into the voice of God that is speaking to us right now. Verse 4 begins what has become known as the Shema, or the Shema Israel, which is a famous prayer that serves as the centerpiece of morning and evening Jewish prayer. The prayer is simple yet profound. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one, the Lord alone. In other words, you have no other gods but God. He and he alone is to be your love. God and God alone is the object of your devotion. This is why the people are reminded to love God with all of their hearts, love God with all of their soul, and love God with all of their strength, because this is about a love relationship. And the Hebrew word that translates here as heart is labab. And it is a word that's used to describe the inner person, the inner state of affairs, the affections, the will, what we like, what we don't like. It has to do with our ability to think and know. It's our personality. It's who we are. And the word that is translated in Hebrew as soul is nefesh. And it is the force that makes us alive. And it symbolizes the purpose of our life, the thing which drives and motivates us. We love God with all of that. And the Hebrew word that is translated as strength is mehod. And it has to do with strength and energy and force. Our lives then are guided by what we think about, what we are passionate about, and what we pour our energy and our strength into. We enjoy and deepen our love relationship with God with the same three things. We love God and draw closer by what we think about, by what we're passionate about, and what we pour our energy and our strength into. What we think about is incredibly important. This is why the Jewish people recited the Shema 2 times every day. They literally believed that what they thought about would affect the way that they lived. So they started and ended every day by thinking about God. So what's the first thing you think about when you get out of bed in the morning? Is it God or, I can't believe I have to go to work today? What's the last thing you think about as you lay your head on the pillow at night? Is it God or is it about everything you have to do tomorrow? What are you passionate about? What do you love to do? What are you interested in? What do you pour the most energy into? Remember, as Moses is talking to the Israelites, he's not suggesting that they think about just any old thing. He's not dropping hints that they should be passionate about any old pursuit. Neither is Moses commending the people to consider giving their energy and strength to just any old cause. Rather, Moses is telling God's people to put the first things first, to make God their first and foremost priority, and then to live that by loving the Lord God with all of their heart, which is all that they love and think about, all of their soul, which is their passion, and all of their might, their energy, and their strength. In order to do this, to be that filled up with the good things of God, they had to stay in tune with God as much as possible. And he instructs the people to spend as much time as possible discussing and thinking and reflecting and meditating on the law and the commandments of God. They literally pray through the Word of God. And that's where the sacred reading comes in. This is why we read, think, pray, and then rest. Now, some people teach that there is a 5th step, and I agree. And that last step is to act, to obey. Prayer should move us into some kind of holy action. Either we are choosing to live more faithfully to God, or we're accepting a new assignment given to us by God during our prayer and sacred reading. And that brings us to the highest aim of prayer, and that is to surrender ourselves completely to God's will. Now, we're going to conclude this series on Palm Sunday with surrender, and that's coming up pretty soon. But we surrender to what we hear God speaking to us through the Spirit and through the Holy Scriptures. In a minute, when we come to prayer, we're going to try out this Lectio. But for now, I bless you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I want to use our prayer time a little bit differently, and we have been over recent weeks. We've been practicing and trying out whatever method of prayer we learned about in the Scriptures. So today, I want to take just a few minutes to experience this divine and sacred reading of Scriptures so that the Scriptures can begin to run loose in our lives, giving us focus, changing us and transforming us, to think and act increasingly like Jesus Christ. And today we're going to practice using Mark chapter 4, verses 35 to 41 as our text. And if you've got a Bible handy, you can open that. It's Mark chapter 4, verses 35 to 41. If you don't have a Bible handy, that's okay. I'm going to read it to us. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to read this scripture out loud, and then we're going to spend a little time doing those 4 things. We're going to read, we're going to think, we're going to pray, and then we're going to rest. Okay? This is the story. It says, "On that day, when evening had come, Jesus said to them, 'Let's go across to the other side.' And leaving the crowd, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. And other boats were with him. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves were breaking into the boat so that the boat was already filling up with water. But he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him, and they said to him, 'Teacher, do you not care that we are dying here?' And he awoke, and he rebuked the wind, and he said to the sea, 'Peace, be still.' And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said to them, 'Why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith?' And they were filled with great fear and said to one another, "Who then is this that even the winds and the sea obey him?" Now I want you to just take a minute and think back over that story. Remember, Jesus is sleeping in the boat. They're crossing over to the other side of the sea, and a great windstorm comes up. And the disciples are terrified, and they cry out to Jesus to save them, and he says to the winds, "Peace, be still." And the storm ceases. I want you to take just a couple of quiet moments and just think that through, and I want you to pay attention to what images, what thoughts, what ideas, what jumps out at you. Now, as you thought back over that story, what phrases caught your attention? What sights, what smells, what sounds, what characters, what moments caught your imagination the most? Do you have questions about it? I want you to pick one thing that came to mind while you thought about that scripture and as you heard it. And I want you to just mull that one thing over in your mind. Doesn't matter if it's a character, if it's some action that happened, if it's a word, an idea, whatever it is, I want you to just think about that one thing for a few moments. Now, whatever you've been mulling over, whatever you've been focusing on, and whatever's come to your mind, thoughts, observations, questions, things you think were cool, things that troubled you, I just want you to tell God about it. Talk to him in silence. The fourth part of this sacred reading is to rest, and that means you don't have to think or say anything. Just sit in silence in God's presence and rest. Finally, what are you going to do about this? Has God revealed anything to you? Or is there anything that's going to change? Has God asked you to do something? What do you feel you should do based on this little time in Scripture and this time with God? Tell God about it and resolve to keep your promise to Him. Loving Lord, we are grateful for the ways in which you communicate and reveal yourself to us. And we thank you. For this quiet time, we pray for the forgiveness of our sins. We pray, Lord, that for the desire to come to you more, to carve a little bit more quiet space in our lives, in our day, in our week, to just be with you, to tell you what's on our mind, and to give you a chance to respond so that we can truly hear. And maybe, Lord, part of that is to open the scriptures and pray, to read, to think, to pray, and to rest. We pray for our nation this week. We continue to pray for our world as the vaccination effort continues. And guide us in the week to come to serve you however you wish. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I thank you all also for the ways that you are supporting the ministries of First United Methodist Church financially. If you have never given remotely with First United Methodist Church, or if you're joining us for the very first time, God has blessed you through this worship experience and you'd like to support us, there's a couple of ways you can do that. One, you can write out a check with your gift to First United Methodist Church of Hanover, and you can mail it through the good old-fashioned post office to our church office, which is 200 Frederick Street, Hanover, PA, 17331. That's Hanover, PA, 17331. Or you can call our church office and you can speak to our financial secretary, Holly. She can set you up on what's known as automatic funds transfer, where your bank talks to the church's bank and you can schedule your donations to go automatically. Or if you're savvy online, you can go to our church website, go to the Giving tab, and select Easy Tithe. Easy Tithe allows you to make a donation using a personal credit or a debit card. We want to thank you for your continued generosity and support of the ministries of First Church. In the time of prayer, whether it was in the scripture, whether it was in the message, learning about how to pray the scriptures, whether it was in the music that we heard or sang, I hope that God has spoken to you today. I believe that God does, whether we worship together here in person or remotely across the miles. This time of worship is about being together, connecting as the body of Christ, but also experiencing some small gift in communication from God. So whatever you receive today, thank God for it, and continue to follow up in the days to come. Talk to God a little bit more about the questions that were raised for you today. Talk a little deeper about the things that God has revealed for you today. I hope that your spring fever is as joyful as mine, and now I want to send you out into the world for another week of service to the kingdom in Christ's name. I bless you, my friends, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, as we go now in peace. Have a great week, everybody. God bless you.